Hello students, and welcome back to Study Room. So today the topic that we're going to be covering is formation of images by spherical mirrors. So now in this topic we are going to be using all of the things that we have learned till now. So you must remember all the laws of reflection, you must remember what a concave and a convex mirror is, and you must remember how we make ray diagrams. We're going to brush up on it as we go, but these are the things that you have to have in mind. And if you're not sure, if you remember, you should go back to the previous videos, watch them over once, and just brush up your memory. Okay, let's go. Now, the topic says construction of ray diagrams for the formation of images by spherical mirrors. So now these are a few points that you have to keep in mind while making the ray diagram. Okay. So the first point that you have to keep in mind is that we have to consider, let's read in the PPT, okay? Consider an extended object of finite size placed in front of a spherical mirror. Each small portion of the extended object acts like a point source. Now, what does this mean? So one thing that you have to remember is we usually represent an object with an arrow. Like we consider the object in front of the mirror like this, okay? Okay, so you will see this in the ray diagrams that we make, that this is how we consider an object and we name the object A, B. Okay, now some things that I'm going to give you a tip about which will make it easier to understand the ray diagram is we name the object. So see that these are some tips that I'm going to be giving you which will make your ray diagram making easier. Okay, the construction of ray diagrams will be easier for you. So we consider the object to be AB and we consider it as an arrow. Okay, that's the first thing. Now, if the image formed by the mirror is virtual and erect, do you remember virtual and erect? I told you the meaning of virtual and erect in one of the previous videos. So virtual basically means that you can't capture it on a screen, and erect means that it is upright. Like the image of this pen, say, is formed like this only. But what if the image of the pen is not formed like this? It is inverted. Inverted means that it is just upside down. Okay, so you will see that this AB and this arrow would come into use when we are portraying how So this arrow and this marking AB would come into use when we are showing how the image is formed. So say this is a mirror, I'm not shading it, this is might be a convex, might be concave, I'm just using an example. So if the image formed here, like we'll draw, this is the mirror, this is the pole, I've not drawn it straight, but you will draw it straight in your copies. So if the image formed is erect, which means it is upright, so it will be formed something like this, and it will be represented by A dash and B dash. So what you have to take care of is the A always comes towards the pointed end of the arrow. See, this even the A dash is near the pointed end of the arrow. Okay, now if the image is not erect, say the image is formed like this, then we call that the image is inverted. So it would be something like, I'm just using the same diagram to show it to you, but there would only be one image formed, obviously, right? This is just for an example. So say the image of this object AB is formed like this. Now, what did I say? That we name the image as A dash, B dash. And we always say that A is near the pointed end. So, would A come here or would A come here? Near the pointed end of the arrow, right? So, then the image would be like this, A dash, B dash. So, we can see that the object, in the object representation, A was at the top and B was at the bottom. But here, B is at the top, B dash, I'm just using the letter B, is at the top and A is at the bottom, which means that if I mark the tip of the pen, if this is A and this is B, right? A is at the top, B is at the bottom. If the image is formed inverted, then here is B, right? B is at the top and A is at the bottom. That means the image has been inverted. So that is why this representation is going to come into a lot of use, this AB representation, okay? Now keep this in mind. I'm just going to erase this so that I can make you understand the rest of the points given here. Okay. Now look at this. This says that we consider an extended object of finite size placed in front of a spherical mirror, and each portion is a point source, which means if this is your object AB, right? So each point on A, this point, this point, this point, this point, this point, there are infinite points on this object. Each point is basically a light source. That means each point gives out some light which will be reflected by the mirror. But think about this, would we be able to draw, say, infinite number of arrows in a ray diagram that we have to draw in our copies? No, right? That just doesn't make sense. So even though each point on the object is a point source of light, even though each point on the object is a point source of light, we only consider two. Okay, so just for simplification purposes, we don't have to consider infinite, right? We just want to get to an answer, to a conclusive answer. So it doesn't matter, we can take 20 rays also, but it would only make our job more tedious, right? It would make our job so long. So we consider two rays because we just need to see where the rays coming from the object are meeting and how is the image formed. What is the shape of the image? Is the image straight or is it inverted? We just have to find out those things. So we only consider two out of these infinite point sources on the object. Okay, so the object is of finite size. It means that it has some dimensions. Say it is a 20 centimeter long object, 3 centimeter long object. So it has some dimension. It's not an infinite object like the sun. Okay, then each point is a source. Okay, but we use only two. This is what we usually do. Maybe in some books you will see 3 rays, 4 rays. That doesn't matter. It just matters how many points we are taking to see how and where the image is formed. Okay, so we usually by convention take 2 points. Now, what does the second point here say? An infinite number of rays originate from each of these points. This is the same thing that I said. Each point is a source. So that means each point, which is this source, gives out light. Therefore, infinite number of rays from these infinite number of points is infinite number of points on the object. Okay, next point. It is convenient to consider only 2 rays for the sake of clarity. Here I have mentioned we use only 2 because that is only 2 are required. We just need to see where these rays meet and how the image is formed. That is it. These rays are so chosen that it is easy to know the direction from reflection of the mirror. Okay, simple. Moving on. Now, we're going to be studying some crucial things that you have to keep in mind while drawing the ray diagrams. These are things that are conventional. They do not change even if it is, say, a concave mirror or a convex mirror or any other mirror. So, these are some things that you will always be using in ray diagrams. So, these are some things that you cannot, absolutely cannot forget. Okay, now, let us look at case 1. When a ray comes parallel to the principal axis. So a ray parallel to the principal axis after reflection will pass through the principal focus. We have done this, if you remember, in the previous classes. In case of a concave mirror, or appear to diverge from the principal focus in case of a convex mirror. You remember how we defined the principal focus of a concave and convex mirror? We said that in case of a concave mirror, the principal focus is the point where the rays coming from infinity converge. And we said that in a convex mirror, the principal focus is the point where all rays from infinity seem to diverge, right? Appear to diverge. If you don't remember, go back and watch the video. Now, we've already read this. Now look at this. This ray is coming from infinity parallel to the principal axis and it is passing through the focus. Now, one thing that you should remember is that the normal line perpendicular to surface of mirror. You remember this normal that we had drawn? This is a very, very, very star, very triple star, very important point that you have to remember is that normal that we have been emphasizing on for so long, that all angles are measured from the normal is perpendicular to the point, is perpendicular to the surface of the mirror. And you remember last time we took, like, if this is the mirror, we considered each small portion of the mirror and we drew a normal to it, and we saw that each portion of the mirror is in a different curved direction, so the normal to it would be in different directions, right? Like this. So one thing that is in common to all of these normals is all the normals pass through the center of curvature, whether it is the convex mirror, whether it is the concave mirror. Now, can you tell me something that is wrong with these two diagrams? Is there something missing in these two diagrams? Something that I have been emphasizing on a lot? Who can tell me? Okay, I'll tell you. If you were able to spot it, very good. You're very strong with your concepts already. The thing these diagrams is missing is the non-reflecting surface. They have not shown, even though you can see that obviously the light is being reflected from here. So it is a concave mirror because the reflecting surface is caving inwards, but it is mandatory for us to show which side is the reflecting and non-reflecting. So always you shade the non-reflecting part like this. This is a convex mirror, so this is the non-reflecting part. Okay, this is something that you have to keep in mind and you have to always show in your ray diagrams. Now, so as you can see here, this line, I'm just making this a full line, but you're supposed to make this a dotted. I'm just making it so that you know which line I'm talking about. What is this line? This line, it is the normal because it is perpendicular to this part of the mirror, right? Because we are considering reflection. You remember when we were doing laws of reflection in case of a plane mirror, we said that what all lie in the same plane? Incident ray, reflected ray, and normal at the point of incidence, right? So normal is always drawn at the point of incidence. So if you can see here, what is the point of incidence here? This point, this small point that I'm drawing an arrow at. This is the point of incidence, right? So we need to have a normal at this point. Now, this triple star point that I was telling you, normal, the perpendicular to the surface of the mirror, in case of spherical mirrors, passes through C. What is C? The center of what is C? The center of curvature. Okay, very, very, very important point. Now, if you have to draw the normal at any point, it will be perpendicular to the that surface of the spherical mirror, but the second thing is that it will always pass through the center of curvature. See, here also, this angle of incidence is equal to the angle of reflection measured from what? From the normal, this normal. And where does this normal pass from? The center of curvature, this C. Now, these are some notations that you have to remember, that the focus is denoted by F, the pole is denoted by P, the center of curvature, I'm just writing curve, is denoted by C. So these are very important symbols that you have to remember. If you see an F, it's the focus, P is the pole, C is the center of curvature. Okay, now this is one thing that you have to remember. So the case here is the ray parallel to the principal axis will pass through the principal focus if it's the concave mirror, or appear to diverge from the principal focus if it is a convex mirror. So in case of a, I'll just draw it here for you. If this is a concave mirror, any line, this is the focus and this is the center of curvature. So if you made the observation, can you see that this distance is the same as this distance? Does look like it, right? Why? What is this whole distance called? From the pole to the center of curvature. Do you remember? Say if this is the sphere that this concave mirror is a part of. What is this distance called from one end to the center? It is nothing but the radius of curvature. And you remember what was the last thing we studied in the previous video was this relation. R is equal to 2F, which means the radius is 2 times the focal length. So if this small, we denote focal length by small f. If this is the focal length, then this whole R is what? Twice of the focal length, right? So that is why this distance is equal to this distance, because this distance is f, and this distance from here to here is also f. So f plus f is what? 2f, and 2f is what? Radius of curvature. That is why this distance, now come to the diagram that I have made here. That is why this distance is equal to this distance. So if you've made your focus and your pole to be at 2 centimeters, so then from your focus to your center of curvature should be also 2 centimeters. So what is the distance of your radius of curvature? It is nothing but 4 centimeters. 2 centimeters plus 2 centimeters. Okay, this was all for your knowledge and recap. This is something that you should remember. This might be asked in some questions also. Okay, so now this ray is coming from infinity. Now at this point, if I draw the normal, it is going to be somewhere around here, and I'm going to make sure that it passes through the center of curvature also. Look, right here. So like this, and I make the angle of incidence I equal to the angle of reflection, so it passes through the focus. Sorry, this shouldn't be dotted. This is a ray. So right here. Okay, so in case of a concave mirror, line parallel to the principal axis passes through the focus. Now, I don't have any space, so I'm just going to erase this and show you what it is in case of a convex mirror. Okay. Now I'm going to show you what it is in case of a convex mirror. So this is the convex mirror you've drawn. Shade the non-reflecting part. And what did we learn about a convex mirror? The sphere is like this. So the center of curvature is somewhere here, because it is always in the middle of the sphere. The focus is somewhere here, middle. So that means it is not, this is the pole P, F and C. So this means that it is not to on the face of the reflecting surface, right? Like in the case of a concave mirror, the pole focus all lies in front of the reflecting surface, right? But in case of a convex mirror, it lies behind the mirror. Okay, so this is something that I told you in the last video also, that you immediately have to visualize. If I say a convex mirror, so you have to think of the sphere, and you immediately have to think, okay, the pole and focus lie behind. So now a ray coming from infinity, this is the ray coming from infinity or parallel to the principal axis, it passes through the focus. Now, can the ray go here? Can the ray go behind the mirror? Absolutely not. How will it go behind the mirror? It has to be reflected from this surface. Obviously, because it is a mirror, so it will be reflected from here. Now, how will it be reflected? How will we draw the normal? So now, if you remember in the last video, we again took this part of the surface and we said, where would the normal be? Somewhere like this. And this will pass through the center of curvature. See? So if you actually make it using your protractor, using your compass, if you take proper measurements, if you take a point here, call it the pole P, you take a point at 2 centimeters focus, from here again you take 2 centimeters the center of curvature, and keep your compass needle here, and draw at 4 centimeters, draw an arc like this, and then shade this, and then draw this line, then take this line coming parallel to the principal axis, and then draw this dotted line passing through the center of curvature. So you have your normal. Then you see from where should this go. If we talked about, now I'm coming back to my original figure. Okay, leave this. Where should this go? It should appear to diverge from the focus. That is what we said, right? Now, what does appear to diverge means? That it, we did this in the last video too, that if we back trace it, it should go through the focus. So another thing you can do is, you can just put your scale like this, passing through the focus and this point. Your scale should be touching this point, and say point A, I'm marking this A, and F. Your scale should be on these two points. You draw a dotted line, you draw a dotted line from F to A, and when you reach A, you just draw the line. And when you reach A, you just draw the line as straight. So you will see, then if you measure this angle, use your protractor and measure the angle between the normal N and this incident ray, maybe whatever the angle is, I, and then you measure the angle between your normal and the reflected ray, R, you will see that I will be equal to R. So our law of reflection would be followed. So what I want you to do, this is a homework for you. You should take proper measurements. Get out your compass, get out your protractor, take proper measurements like I told you and draw these. And you will see how perfectly your diagram comes out. Okay. So I hope this is clear now, that in case of a concave mirror, it converges at the focus. The line passing parallel to the principal axis passes through the focus. And here, in case of a convex mirror, as I've shown right here, it appears to diverge from the focus. That it looks like the ray coming from the focus is reflected like this. Even though the light can't go behind the mirror, that's why it's a dotted line, which means it's an imaginary line. So that's why we say appear to diverge, because it's not in real life diverging from the focus, because the focus is anyway behind the mirror. But this is just for your understanding. Okay. Now, case 2. A ray passing through the principal focus. So I think this would be very obvious. If it is passing, the last case that we did, parallel to principal axis, passes through focus. Now just change the direction, passes through focus, parallel to principal axis, just the opposite of it. So there is not much to explain here, that if this is a concave mirror and this is your pole, this is your principal axis, this line that I draw, don't forget these important terminologies that we did, okay? What is the pole? What is the focus? What is this line called the principal axis? So this is F. I would draw it almost at the same distance that the pole is from F. I'll draw it same here, because the radius of curvature is 2 times the focal length. You will be drawing using a scale, so you should exactly draw it at a midpoint, or the exact distance of PF should be the exact same distance of CF. Okay, now line passing through focus, ray passing through focus. There we go. Now, how do we do the reflection? Do we just do it however we want to? No, we always draw normal. So the normal at this point, where would it pass through? Come on, quick trivia for you. It would pass through the center of curvature. So we draw this line passing through the center of curvature and meeting it at this point. And then we draw this line, which would be parallel to principal axis. So if a ray passes through focus, it would be parallel to principal axis after reflection. Do this. You should never believe what someone tells you. What if I'm telling you the lie? You should never believe what someone tells you. What if I'm telling you a lie? What if I'm just bluffing with you? So, what you should always do is, you should always go back and check it yourself. You are studying science. Science is always something that can be verified in one way or another. And these are ray diagrams. You just do it on paper. So, like this, you can verify it. And like this, you can tell if I am lying to you or not. Okay. So, what you should do is, you should check if I am lying to you or not by taking proper measurements, by drawing the normal through the center of curvature, and by drawing it parallel to the principal axis. And how will you verify it? By checking if this angle of incidence is equal to the angle of reflection. It might not be exactly the same, like if it might be a little different, but it won't be like the angle of incidence is 30 degrees and the angle of reflection is 40 degrees. not that big of a difference. It would be a very small difference. Okay, so this is a homework for you, and it will be very interesting when you do it. Now, in case of a concave mirror, this was this. In case of a convex mirror, again, principal axis. Now, focus lies behind the mirror. F, center of curvature is here. A line that passes through the focus. Now, a ray can't come like this and pass through the focus, right? No, this ray can't come behind the mirror. No ray can go behind the mirror. So, what do? We draw a ray that looks like it is passing through the focus. That means you take a dotted line from here, and when you reach the mirror, you draw a straight line because this is an actual ray, right? You only draw a dotted line for lines that are actually imaginary. Like the normal is not actually there. You can see the incident ray coming, a light ray coming. You can see the light ray reflected. So incident ray and reflected ray aren't imaginary rays. But the normal we are drawing for our convenience, so that we can measure the angle of incidence and angle of reflection. The normal isn't actually there. There is no normal. We are drawing for our sake. So that is why we draw it dotted. Similarly, no line can be here. There can be no ray behind the mirror, but we are drawing it for our convenience so that we are able to make the ray diagrams properly. So now, because in case of a convex mirror, the line ray can't actually go through the focus because the focus is behind the mirror. So we show a ray that looks like it is going through the focus. Like if this ray comes here. Now suppose, that is why a dotted line, because it is not in there in real life. Suppose it passes through the focus like this. Then what happens? Again, what do? We need a, whenever you see an incident ray, what do we need? Next thing, always a normal. And how do we draw a normal? Always through the center of curvature. Now these are some things that should be on your tips. As soon as I ask them, you should be able to answer them. So this part, the normal would pass through the center of curvature. Again, dotted line through here. Keep going. When you reach the mirror, this time it would not be a full line because the normal is an imaginary line. Now, again, you do this angle of incidence equal to angle of reflection. So you would see that the ray comes out like this. So first two things we learned was ray coming parallel to the principal axis passes through the focus. Second thing, passing through the focus, it comes out after reflection as parallel to the principal axis. Now, please, it is my humble request to you that draw these diagrams by yourself or you will not be able to understand what I'm trying to say. Okay, sit with a pen, paper, a compass and a protractor. Do it, not pen, a pencil, a paper, a compass and a protractor, and do it for yourself. Okay, now moving on. Third case, a ray passing through the center of curvature. Now, this is very interesting. Look, now I draw a concave mirror. Now you are going to be telling me the answer because now you know enough. Okay, this is F. Almost equal distance pe we draw C. Now, in case of a concave mirror, because a ray can pass here, so we do not draw a dotted ray. We draw this ray passing through the center of curvature. Now, what is the next thing we need? We need a normal. Now, where does the normal pass through? Through the center of curvature only. So, this line that you've drawn as your incident ray is actually your center of curvature only. So, now what do? Do I make it dotted? I'll try. Okay. I can't make it because it's already a ray. So, I'm just drawing it near this. Okay. To show you that this is also your normal. This is not over it. It is actually the same line. But I need you to know what I'm doing. So, I'm drawing this dotted ray. This is the same line. Now, if this is my normal and this is my incident ray, usually what do? The incident ray is like this. So, it has some angle. But right now, this is my normal. I hope you can see. This is my normal and this is my incident ray. So, what is the angle between the normal and incident ray? It's 0 degrees, right? Obviously, if this is your normal, say, you've drawn the normal like this. Now, what you usually do is, okay, this is the incident ray. This is how the incident ray comes and it gets reflected at an equal angle. So, you measure it from the normal. But what is happening now? Now, what is happening is, if this is your normal, your incident ray is like this. Now what do? Now where do you measure the angle? You can't be like, oh, where is the angle? Because there is no ray over or below the normal. So here the angle of incidence is 0 degree. So what would be the angle of reflection? It would be 0 degree. So that means that if a ray, I'll just draw this again so that you don't get confused. Now you know where the normal lies, right? So if this is a ray that is passing through the center of curvature, so it is going to be reflected at 0 degrees to the normal again. Now, what is the normal? This line itself is the normal. What is the normal? This line itself is the normal. So, where does the ray get reflected? Back on this line only, because the ray also has to get reflected at 0 degree, because the incident ray was at 0 degrees with the normal. So, the ray also passes like this on the same path. So that means a ray passing through the center of curvature retraces its path. Now look at this. A ray passing through the center of curvature of a concave mirror or directed in the direction of the center of curvature of a convex mirror after reflection is reflected back along the same path. Let's do it in case of a convex mirror also. This is your convex mirror. Now, because a ray can't actually pass through the center of curvature, we make it look like it is passing by the dotted line. So, if a ray has to pass through the center of curvature, say this is the ray. What you can do is you can actually draw a ray like this, and then you can use your eraser and make this line dotted by erasing small bits of it. But I can't do that here. So, what I do is I take a dotted line passing through the center of curvature. When we reach the mirror, because the ray can actually exist here, when we reach the mirror, we draw this like this. So that means this is a ray that is not, we can't say a ray that is passing through the center of curvature in the case of a convex mirror. Why? Because the ray can't go through the center of curvature. Why? Because the ray can't go behind the mirror. Right? I hope now this concept is very clear to you. Why I say in case of convex mirror, I always say appear to diverge, looking like it's passing through, because it's not actually passing through the center of curvature because it's behind the mirror. So this dotted line shows that it is directed in the direction of the center of curvature. Again, we draw the normal at this point A. Can you see this point that I'm emphasizing? I'm drawing it, making it more thick. Again, at this point A, if you want to draw the normal, where would the normal go through? Through the center of curvature. So this is my normal. I'm just drawing it again. This is my normal. So, again, incident ray at 0 degrees to the normal, reflected ray would be at 0 degrees to the normal. So, it would just be reflected back like this. So, it goes through the center of curvature, 0 degrees. So, it comes back at 0 degrees. Okay? Now, case 4 is a ray incident obliquely. Obliquely means at any random angle. So, let's read. A ray incident obliquely to the principal axis towards a point P, that is the pole of the mirror, on the concave mirror or a convex mirror is reflected obliquely. The incident and reflected ray follow the laws of reflection at the point P, making equal angles. Simple. Look. Obliquely means it can be any angle. It doesn't have to be any specific angle. It doesn't have to be any specific angle. So, any random angle, say this is F and this is C. Now, at this point, any ray incident like this. So again, what do? We need the normal at this point, at point A, this thick point that I've drawn. I hope you can see. So what do? We consider this surface of the mirror and we try to draw a ray at 90 degree. And it should also pass through the center of curvature. So what line does it come out to be? It actually comes out to be your principal axis only. So your principal axis here is the normal. Because look, this is the point that you want to at the pole, because the ray is hitting the pole. This is the P, pole of the mirror. So if the ray is hitting the pole like this, you want to draw a normal at this surface. This is what we always do. The point, we take small surface at that point, and the 90 degree would be, I've made the point very thick. I shouldn't make it that thick. This surface, right? And at this surface, the 90 degree would be like this. If you take it in the other direction too, this comes out to be your principal axis only. Okay? So, what happens? Your principal axis, this line is only your normal. So, that means your principal axis is your point, is your normal. So, that means if this is the angle I from the principal axis or the normal in this case, so it would be reflected like this at an equal angle R, like this. Simple. Okay, I hope you've understood it. So in also in the case of a convex mirror, we can show it like this. Okay, so any ray, the focus is here, this the center of curvature is here. Any ray obliquely incident, that means at any random angle. So now, at this point, again, where is the normal? Passing through the center of curvature, right here, perpendicular to this line, comes out to be your principal axis only. So, if this is your normal, then your angle is I, like this. And at the same angle, it has to be reflected like this, at R. Okay? So, this is how... Oh, I forgot to draw the arrows. Arrows are very important to show in which direction your ray is going. Don't forget to make the arrows ever. Okay? Moving on. Now, the nature, position and size of the image formed by a concave mirror. So, the experiment says that keep a burning candle at a position far beyond C, that means the center of curvature of a mirror. Place a paper screen and move it in front of the mirror till you obtain a sharp image. That means you take a candle and you take a paper screen. Now you keep moving it and you see where you obtain an image. Okay, so this is basically to tell you that where would the image be formed if the object is kept here. Like if you say if the object is kept at infinity, where would the image be formed? If the object is kept between the C and F, that means the center of curvature and focus, where would the image be formed? So these are the cases that you are going to be doing. So we'll be noting down, this is something that you can do at home again. So you'll note down the nature, like is it erect, straight, or is it inverted, upside down, and the position where it is formed, and the relative size. Is the image form bigger than the candle? Is the image form smaller, or is the image form exactly the same size? Okay. Now the result is for all cases except one, we get real and inverted image. Don't worry, you will draw the ray diagrams and understand this better.